So, good morning everyone. Today we'll be starting with this particular topic in antivirals in vaccine scenario. The topic today is focused specifically on designing and screening of antivirals. What are antivirals that we are talking about from past few lectures? What are antivirals? See, antivirals are the compounds that can cause inhibition in pathogenesis or disease which is induced by viruses. In short, we are calling as antivirals because it is working against the virus. Then how these molecules are being designed, how these antivirals are designed, and how among the plethora of chemicals that we have n number of drugs. We have n number of drugs. How we screen them to say putatively that yes, out of the pool, this drug is effective against this virus. Now, what I said, this drug is effective against this virus, whether it's a new drug, whether it's a repurposed drug, whether it's a drug which is already available in the market, but we are using it for screening and we are using it for a particular kind of virus. So today we'll be studying this particular topic in brief detail, telling us that what is the chronology of the event that is happening before going for any kind of designing, what are the concepts that you should keep in mind when we are studying a virology or when we are studying any kind of virus. So the basic learning objectives of this particular lecture will be just to identify and have a better understanding of what can be the potential targets. What can be the potential targets that can be targeted by a certain person in designing an antiviral. Now, what targets I am talking about here? I'm not talking about any sort of, you know, physical target. I'm talking about the molecular targets. Now, what are molecular targets? See, a virus, when it infects the cell, after infection, it goes for increasing its number, its replication cycle, synthesis of viral protein, modulation of immune responses. So there are multiple pathways that are coordinated to give rise to an infection. Among those coordinated pathways, there are multiple proteins that are coming together in executing that function. So whether we can choose or target those proteins in order to inhibit the completely inhibit that viral infection, and then whether that virus, what is the mode of infection of those viruses, and based on those mode, how we go about screening all those drugs. So out when we are through with this lecture, I expect that you would be able to understand the complete phenomena that how we go about for the screening of any kind of bioactive agent that can be called as an antiviral drug. And then you will also be able to have a basic understanding of, you know, how to find an effective drug, what can be the putative strategies that can be employed in the terms of drug discovery, and what is the path of, you know, putting a drug from bench to clinic. When I am talking about that, I am working in a lab, I am actively working in the lab and working on this particular molecule that is performing X function. Then from my laboratory, to putting inside in a clinic, to putting it for general use of human population. What are the different stages? What is the total expenditure? That we'll be talking about in this particular lecture. So before going to, you know, in depth of what are antivirals, what is the function of those viruses, how those viruses are causing the infections, let us first see what is the spectrum of diseases that are caused by viral infections, and what are the different kinds of viruses that are affecting our organ system, what are the organ systems that are being affected. So let us take an example of the current scenario, the pandemic scenario. We are calling it a SARS-CoV-2, which is causing COVID-19 disease. What is COVID-19 disease? It is affecting our lungs. That means it is infecting our respiratory system. Then what are the other viruses? The other viruses are earlier variants, MERS, SARS-CoV-1. Then influenza virus, both type A and type B. Whether it is para-influenza virus, all these are known to cause respiratory disorders. Not only respiratory organ, but your gastroenteritis, the complete alimentary canal organ, the adenovirus, the rotavirus, the second effects of coronavirus is also shown here. Then skin infection, there are multiple viruses that causes derm, they are called as dermatophytes, which infects the skin cells. Be it zoster virus, be it smallpox virus, be it measles virus or rubella virus. or we are talking, whether we are talking about in terms of eye conjunctivitis, what we have seen that is caused by a cytomegalovirus, or we are talking about the infection of adenovirus. Then there is encephalopathies or meningitis or common cold or pharyngitis or cardiovascular impairment by Coxsackie B virus. So every organ type can be targeted by a viral family, by a certain member of viral family. That's why it becomes important for us to understand its complete function and to design antivirals which can work against this infection. Now the question comes. Now what is the question? Whether we are designing an antiviral, a single antiviral will be capable of inhibiting all these viruses, be it sexually transmitted virus like HIV, herpes simplex virus, papillomavirus, or we have to carefully understand the pathogenesis and mode of infection of each of the virus and then specifically design a selective drug which will target the selective virus. Then answer is both can happen. Both can happen. As a researcher, you cannot put yourself with a string of horse and you can see in one direction. No. There might be a drug which can prove effective against a plethora of viruses, multiple viruses, a broad spectrum antiviral compound. And there can be certain drugs which can inhibit a specific virus. And there, on the contrary, there might be certain viruses which can eventually become resistant towards the drugs what you are using. So you have to design the specific compounds also, which will be specifically used in case of these viruses. Like acyclovir, what we are using, acyclovir or amitriptyline or neuraminidase inhibitors that we are using in influenza case. Fine. So we should be well versed with this overall viral phenomena, the pathogenesis, if we are working in this particular area. If I am working in designing the drug against, let's say, influenza, then I should be able to understand the complete mode of infection, the pathogenesis of influenza in causing the pneumonia, or we call it as respiratory disorder, so that I should be available. I should be made available of the information that what are the proteins and what are the molecules that are mediating that effect after viral infection, so that I can target that. And second point, when we are going for selective targeting, not only in antiviral compound, any type of, whether we are talking about anti-cancer agent, whether we are talking about anti-inflammatory agents, if we are going for selective targeting, that means I am selectively inhibiting one target out of 100 targets. And that one target is that much potent that if I inhibit that target, then the complete pathway will be shut down and there will be no viral infection. Then those type of antiviral compounds give you maximum therapeutic gain. So with that in mind, this preamble in mind, let us go ahead and discuss about understanding the virus. See, these are few basic slides that I've incorporated. We all understand that what are viruses. Viruses, they require host, to perform their function, to increase their number. If they're outside the host, they cannot do anything. Once they go inside the host, they get the opportunity to capture all the machinery, all the nutrients, all the enzymes and the proteins that are required to replicate them. So to gain an entry inside a host, they should first attach onto the host and then get enter inside the cell. Now these, after getting inside the cell, these viruses have in their genome contains DNA as well as RNA. It can be single-strand DNA, it can be double-strand DNA, it can be single-strand RNA of positive and negative sense, it can be double-strand RNA also. So there is a variety of genomic structure inside this particular viral molecule. They can contain a single strand, they can contain even triple strand of RNA molecules. But once they get inside the host cell, they start synthesizing the proteins that they are coding, and also they start capturing the host protein and perform the function for their own benefit. So that's why we should understand that when we are talking about the virus, we are not talking about a single pathogen, but we are talking about the complete coordinated process that a single virus is inducing inside the host cell. And we have to keep in mind that when we are using antiviral, we are targeting an an infectious agent, a pathogen, which eventually had entered inside our cell. So we might have to cause certain toxicity inside our cell in order to remove this particular virus. That is the thing why they are not easy to kill. Why? Because they are endogenous viruses. Because they grow endogenously. Now, any drug that kills a virus may also kill your cells. That's what I told you. It might induce certain toxicity. Now, when we are talking about the antivirals, they may be available for multiple kind of infections. Viruses can control multiple antiviral therapies are available, like cytomegaly virus or hepatitis virus, herpes virus, influenza virus. Is this possibility? So when we are talking about any kind of antiviral drug, we have to understand that those drugs will be binding they will be inhibiting the certain steps. They will be inhibiting the certain steps of this viral pathogenesis. Now, when we say that viruses require the complete host machinery, of course, we say that this is obligatory. The viruses are obligate parasites, obligate intracellular parasites. Now, when I showed you this particular image, let us see this particular image. Just to recapitulate what we understand with the virus, this is the virus. This is a viral molecule, right? This is a viral molecule. This blue color shell that is present outside is called as envelope. And this particular golden layering is called as capsid. And inside we are having RNA genome. So certain viruses contain the capsid and RNA only. There is no envelope. We call them as naked virus. And certain contains, some type of viruses contain the envelope on outside, and those are called as envelope viruses. Now, why I'm telling you that? I'm telling you why. Just focus on this particular slide. See, on this particular envelope, there are multiple protrusions that are coming out of the membrane, coming out of the envelope, which is again a lipopolysaccharide. Now, these protrusions are glycoproteins, and these protrusions are responsible for attaching on the surface of the membrane of a host cell. So this is eventually acting as a ligand of attaching to the receptor, which will be used to cause infection. So if I understand the complete, this is an example of influenza virus. So if I understand the complete structural part of this particular virus, I understood that there is a presence of hemagglutinin, there is a presence of neuraminidase molecule. I can target these proteins and I can make a structural mimic, thereby inhibiting the binding of these spikes. Suppose this is a virus, this is a spike, and this is a receptor. It can go and bind to this receptor, thereby it will go inside the cell. If I can somehow inhibit this binding and I can block this thing, this receptor, then this virus will not be able to cause infection into other normal cells. But how will I inhibit this? For this, I should be able to know that the structure of this protrusion, and thereby I should take an antiviral compound which resembles this structure. And these are the strategies that are adopted. For these strategies, we should be able to understand completely that what exactly a virus looks like, how exactly that viruses are moving about. Fine. Then, not only these antivirals. See, although we are talking about antivirals, but the another critical part is determining what virus has infected. Then only you will be able to administer the antiviral. That is called as diagnosis. For diagnosis, what you will do? If I give you an influenza virus, you will see what you will decipher. You will be deciphering based on either antibodies towards them, then those antibodies or the ELISA method or any kind of RT-PCR. If you are talking about RT-PCR, they will be targeting the genome. But if I am using any kind of antibody, that will be targeting the surface antigen, and those surface antigens are present on the envelope, and those antigens are nothing but these spike proteins or these protrusions that are coming out. So you see, we have to clear-cut understand that what are the things that we can target in order to design an antiviral compound. Now, just to tell you about, after deciphering the surface, just to tell you that what are the different categories or the stages that can be targeted. Let us see an example of influenza A virus. Then we'll be seeing an example of coronavirus also. Influenza A virus, how it enters and how it increases its number. This is called its replication cycle. So once the virus has encountered the cell, it will bind to the receptor. It will bind to the receptor. This is called as attachment. After attachment, this will be endocytosed inside the cell. It will go inside the cell inside a lumen of an endosome, which is nothing but an invagination of cell membrane. This will be endosome. Fine. So this process is called as endocytosis, and it is mediated by certain proteins which are present here, called as cladrin proteins. After endocytosis, the pH inside this endocytosis changes. It changes, and this change in pH results in the change in the conformation of this virus, thereby causes the release of the capsid along with the RNA, along with its genome. The capsid is now removed. This is called as uncoating, and the genome goes inside the nucleus, where it goes about synthesizing its protein. Now, influenza is an RNA virus. So that RNA results in the formation of protein. Now, those proteins are what? Those proteins are either proteases or RNA-dependent RNA polymerases, which are required to increase its number. So what it will do? It will first increase its number. Simultaneously, it is resulting in the formation of its proteins. Now, when the proteins, viral proteins are formed and the RNA is completely formed, then based on the stoichiometry, the packaging is performed. Now the genome is now ready and the proteins are now ready. Now a complete viral particle is to be formed, and that packaging is done inside the cytoplasm, and then it is combining via the root of endoplasmic reticulum and Golgi body. The complete mature particle is released, and the packaged particle is forms a bud, and it is removed out of the cell to infect other normal cells. This is a normal viral replication performed with an example of influenza A virus. But we are talking about antivirals. Then why it is so important? See, we can have a drug, we can design an antiviral compound which can block this attachment. So at the first stage itself, you are blocking the attachment with the receptor. So no influenza virus will be able to enter inside. Fine. If somehow the efficiency of that binding is not up to the mark, then I have to look for other targets. Then if I can inhibit the process of endocytosis, or I can inhibit the process of uncoating, or I can inhibit the process of replication, or I can inhibit the enzyme that is required for increasing the viral RNA, called as RNA-dependent RNA polymerase, or I can inhibit the proteases that is being secreted by this, that is being formed by this particular viral protein. If I can inhibit these viral protein, or if I can inhibit this particular packaging, fine. So you see what we did. We understood the complete chronology of the events. We understood that from the virus, the point of attachment to the release of the virus, what are the different processes that are being used. And we are targeting those processes. If I am talking about the blocking of the attachment, what I am targeting? I am targeting the receptor. So it becomes my putative target. Likewise, if I am blocking the replication, what I am targeting? I am targeting the enzyme that will perform that particular function. So that becomes my putative target. So once I am well versed, once I have taken the complete information of the replication mode or the mode of infection or pathogenesis of the disease, I should be able to design those antivirals. Similarly, just to give you a glimpse of the current pandemic scenario in which we are prevailing, the coronavirus scenario. See, the virus is getting attached to a particular receptor. The receptor is ACE2. So what we did? The first drug which was put into the world platform was hydroxychloroquine. Now it's not a new drug. It's already being used as an antimalarial drug in some other clinical scenario. So what we did, we already identified a pool that yes, these drugs are approved by the FDA, and if we screen these drugs and somehow any of the drug is found putative, we need not to go for again toxicology studies. So what is happening? This hydroxychloroquine is what it is inhibiting the attachment. It is inhibiting the attachment with this receptor. Fine, it is inhibiting the attachment with this receptor. Then we talk about remdesivir, we talk about flavipir, what it is doing. It is inhibiting the RNA-dependent RNA polymerase. We talk about lopinavir. We talk about ritonavir, which are again antiviral and used against corona infection. What they are doing? They are inhibiting the CLPRO, that is a protease enzyme which is responsible for cleavage of viral proteins. We are using monoclonal antibodies like IL-6, specifically IL-6 antibodies, anti-IL-6 antibodies. What they are doing? They are directly going, those antibodies are going and binding to the receptors and neutralizing the viral particle. Then dexamethasone that is used. Dexamethasone, what it is doing? It inhibits the inflammatory reaction, which is again a bystander effect of viral infection. We are using interferons as a therapy. Why? Because one of the mode of infection of virus is blocking the interferon pathway. So if we can channelize the interferon inside the body, it will stimulate our immune system to respond to that viral function, and that viral function can be removed from the cell by antibody mediated cytotoxicity or humoral immunity. So what we are doing, we are substantiating our immunity also. So in nutshell, what I wanted to tell you, in nutshell, if you see the complete pathway of attachment, of endocytosis, of replication, and thereby after packaging and release, we are able to target each and every pathway because we understand that what are the players that are playing their crucial role in this scenario. And this is how a drug is put forward. This is how a drug is investigated to be an antiviral compound. Whether we are talking about monoclonal antibody, whether we are talking about receptor antagonist, whether we are talking about certain enzyme inhibitors, whether we are talking about certain endocytosis inhibitors. So all these are first investigated and then put forward as a treatment module. So what we understood till now? We understood that we need to understand the complete mode of infection properly, with the series of events and the players involved in it, and then only we can use our knowledge of chemical database to extract a compound which can be regarded as an antiviral compound against a certain putative target. So with that in mind, let us see what are antiviral drugs. Once we have established that, yes, what we are calling as putative targets, by taking example of two viruses. Likewise, if you are working for any kind of other virus, you should first understand the mode of infection. Now, what are antiviral drugs? See, there are broad categories of antiviral drugs. Some of them are quinone molecules, some of them are purine molecules, some of them are base analogs, some of them are specific inhibitors. So chemically, or we should say a biochemically, it's the spectrum is very large. Let us see few by examples and let us see what functions they are performing. So when we're talking about antiviral drug, many of the antiviral drugs are purine or pyrimidine analogs. Now, what are analogs? Analogs are which resembles in structure. Purine and pyrimidine, A, T, G, C. A and G and T and C. A and G are purine, adenosine and guanosine, whereas thymidine and cytosine are pyrimidine. So there are certain molecules or certain drugs which are mimicking or which are performing analog function that resembles in structure with these particular purine pyrimidines. Now consider a scenario. I am just giving you a scenario. Suppose virus infected a cell. After infection, it started formation its RNA. It started increasing the number of RNA. So it is called as viral genome replication. Now, in order to increase its length, it requires purine and pyrimidines, and those purines and pyrimidines are provided by host cell, right? So suppose if I add a drug and that drug is resembling guanosine, and the enzyme will not be able to distinguish between guanosine and my drug. So once the viral replication is starting, eventually, instead of guanosine, my drug is now incorporated in the RNA molecule. What will happen? The complete replication of RNA will be stopped. That means the virus will not be able to increase its number. Now, you may ask the question that how my drug is getting incorporated when it is competing with guanosine? Because I am providing a high dose. I am providing a dose which will provide sufficient amount of drug inside the cell, which will surpass the guanosine, and it will be used by that RNA dependent RNA polymerase of virus. and thereby it will inhibit the viral replication. This is the function of how these analogs are working. So the category can be purine and pyrimidine also, and majority of the drugs are released as prodrugs. Prodrugs means which require certain processing to become active drug, right? Like in enzymes, we call it as zymogen and active enzyme. Likewise, in drug, there are prodrugs which are administered, and once the processing has been taken place, then those prodrugs are converted into active drugs. Now, how those are converted? See, in certain cases of antiviral compounds, the processing that is required to convert the prodrug into an active drug is called as phosphorylation. So if you phosphorylate a prodrug, it is getting converted into an active drug. Now, that phosphorylation can be performed by any kind of viral protein, or it can be performed by the host protein also. We have that, but those particular enzymes that are responsible for phosphorylation. What is the category? The category is kinase. All the kinases enzymes can cause phosphorylation, and among that, specifically thymidine kinase can cause the phosphorylation of a kind of a product called as acyclovir. Fine. Then what is the, in nutshell, these antiviral drugs are doing? They are blocking the viral replication. So that the viral growth cannot be resumed, and the infected cells should not be able to release multiple viral particles to infect the other normal cells. Fine. But once you remove the drug, what will happen? Whether that viral particle again starts replicating, or it is now cleared, that is what is investigated when we are putting forward a drug. That what is the timeline that we are talking about? What is the concentration of the dose that we are talking about? What is the dose that is relevant for this particular inhibition, but simultaneously it is not causing any kind of toxicity to the normal cells? So what are the key features that we talk about for an antiviral drug? It should be able to enter the cell first of all. That is the most critical part. See, the viral antigen has entered inside the cell. It's an endogenous antigen. Now, whatever I am giving as a treatment, it should be able to cross my selectively permeable plasma membrane, cell membrane. So it should be able to cross the cell and infect the virus. Fine. Then if I am aiming to inhibit the viral replication, then the drug should be such that it should be able to interfere in nucleic acid synthesis or its regulation. It should impair the synthesis of nucleotides. Fine. Then there are certain drugs which do not perform this, but they are able to interact with the virus directly and bind to it. Fine. Then there are drugs which enter inside the cell and then they elicit the immune response. The immune response, which was initially suppressed by the virus, the drugs further remove this suppression and cause our immune cells to respond, and thereby providing the sufficient time to clear that pathogen. Fine. Now, whatever the antiviral drug we are talking about, please keep in mind, the best army against the virus is your immune system. If a drug is there which is supporting the immune system, the drug will do wonders as an antiviral agent. Why? Because it itself is acting and it also substantiating the immune system to clear that particular pathogen, and it will cause minimum toxicity. So an healthy immune system is very much required. So that there are compounds which are first investigated for their immunomodulatory properties. Simultaneously, they are also investigated for their antiviral properties. Then let's talk about antiviral history. After understanding the characteristics, let us see how this concept of antivirus or antiviral compounds came into this thing. Then we have to go back to the early 1950s when chemists were looking at the different kinds of antibiotics. And at that time, pox virus was causing havoc, because in 1950s, soon after the World War II, the smallpox was still the major threat. And at that time, people were continuously performing experiments to, you know, isolate a compound that can be putative against inhibiting this particular smallpox. So they synthesized a compound called as thiosemicarbazone, which was used against certain kinds of pox viruses. Then again, from that was no there was no understanding of the viral chronology, so that a particular protein can be targeted. They were going by a strategy called as blind screening. Now what is blind screening? In 60s, 70s, till 70s, it was all blind screening. Why? Because the instrumentations were not advanced to, you know, to decipher the complete molecular pathways. Now what is blind screening? I have not seen any kind of replication. I am not understanding any kind of putative targets. I don't know anything about it. All I know is there is a virus which is causing a disease. I have a repository of multiple compounds. I have 1,000 drugs. I will take one drug at a time and I will treat for seeing whether there is any therapeutic grain. No, if there is no therapeutic grain, I'll remove that drug. I'll again take a new drug, and one by one, by hit and trial method, I will keep looking whether this particular drug is able to perform any antiviral function. If it is able to perform any antiviral function, then perhaps I'll be able to go and decipher what kind of mechanism, by which mechanism it may be suppressing. Fine. So what are the pros and cons? See, the big disadvantage is we are taking too much of time. We are giving too much of effort. Fine. We are going first blind and then going inside what is it, what exactly is happening. The promising part is from the thousands of compound, we are getting the lead molecules. Suppose we got 10 molecules which are having a basic structure of quinone. So we understood that quinone family is actually the family which is responsible for antiviral action against these viruses. So it gives you a promising molecule which can act as a lead, and that particular molecule can be modified chemically. That particular quinone family molecule can be modified chemically to reduce the cytotoxicity, to increase the bioavailability. What is bioavailability? Once you have taken a dose, how much you have taken 1 mg medicine, 1 mg of tablet. Now out of that 1 mg, how much amount will be going to your lungs, will be going to your kidney, will be going to your liver? How that 1 mg is distributed inside the body, that is called as bioavailability. And what we want that out of that 1 mg, maximum percentage should go to the infected tissue where the virus has infected. So that is called as improving the bioavailability, and that can be done after knowing that what is the molecule and chemically modifying it. Fine. So that is club, and it has been given a notion of bioavailability and, you know, pharmacokinetics studies. Now out of those 1,000 molecules that are made, certain specific antivirals will be selected which showed the inhibition of virus in laboratory, and those will be taken ahead. Those positive will be taken ahead in the animal model, and then they'll be taken further ahead in the human trials or clinical trials. Likewise, a drug called as amantadine. This is a structure of amantadine which was approved in the late 1960s for influenza A infections. Now, till date, although it was approved in 1960s, till date, the prime three drugs which are used for this particular influenza A infection, out of those three, the one of the prominent is amantadine, which is regularly used. What is the mechanism? Nobody investigated the mechanism after 1960s. All were happy to see that yes, it is getting infected, because there was lack of instrumentation. But once the bio instrumentation went to a revolutionary changes, then in 1990s its complete mechanism was deciphered. So that was happening before 1990s, or you should say in last century. But what about today, when we are already advanced so much in this particular system? Nowadays we use sophisticated chemistry tools to design selective drugs against targets which we know that are crucial for viral disease pathogenesis by virus. We use recombinant DNA technology, we use clone genes from viruses to express them genetically. We understand the life cycles of majority of the virus, so that we need not to generalize the treatment. We can have a specific treatment for a specific viruses. Fine. So all those blind screening that was used to done previously is not done now. Why? Because going for an experimental verification just to see, or experimental screening just to see which is a lead molecule, is not worth it because it's taking too much of resources, too much of time. Right now, when I'm aware of the target, I can use that target and perform a high throughput screening. I can perform a bioinformatic analysis to see which drug is docking to that particular target. And I can very easily from that 1,000 repository come to a short repository of 10 to 15 most potent molecules. So today, combinatorial approaches are being followed. And this particular representation gives you a glimpse that how these antivirals are being being used. See, in case of HIV, if I'm talking about inhibiting that attachment, then we use peptide analogs. We use interferons if we want to suppress the bystander effects, and if we want to elicit the immune responses, if we want to inhibit the protein synthesis that is used in the case of hepatitis A, B, and C. We use certain antisense oligonucleotides like small interfering RNA, siRNA, miRNA that is used as an antiviral therapy. It inhibits the synthesis of mRNA and it inhibits the translation process, a viral translation process, as is used against the case of cytomegaloviruses. So what in nutshell I am representing here, I am telling you that today we are not going for blind staining, we are going for specific targeting, inhibiting the specific stage that we are interested in, and thereby putting forward an antiviral drug. So what is the path of drug discovery? What is the path of drug discovery that we are talking about? See, the path of drug discovery is, you have to identify the need. You have to identify the need first. Then you have to understand what is the interaction that is going on between the cell and the virus. Once you have understood the relevant mechanism completely by different techniques, then you have to put forward multiple drugs into see that whether that particular mechanism is getting inhibited or not. If that mechanism is getting inhibited, ultimately it will lead to suppression of viral infection. Now, how it is investigated? There are multiple approaches. One is in silico bioinformatic tools. If you have the structure, you can decipher the complete screening. There are certain other methods. The wet lab method, where a normal cell line based study can be done, where a normal enzyme based inhibition studies can be done, a cell based sensor studies can be done, depending upon what mechanism exactly has become relevant for your research. Then once you have identified a putative target, then you come with a lead compound. Then this lead compound is not directly put forward for any kind of, you know, medicinal uses. No. This is all in vitro. Now you have to shift your molecule testing to animal testing, that is in vivo. You will use mice or rat models to first decipher, to first narrate clearly that this lead compound is actually able to inhibit the viral infection and how it is more potent compared to other viral antivirals that are already available in the market. If you are saying that compared to that, it is not causing much of the significant difference, then why I should approve you? There is already a drug. Why I should additionally provide a chemical insult to my tissue? So all those toxicology studies, the metabolic studies, the pharmacological studies are performed after this scenario. And then if a drug is doing good in animal studies, it is put forward for clinical trials. And in this animal model, your job is to decipher what is the in vivo effect of this particular drug, how it will cause, how much percentage it is causing inhibition of virus infection, what is the bioavailability of different organs, how this particular compound is distributed in the tissue, at what rate. Once I have entered this particular compound in, suppose, a rat, what time the drug is taking to get clear out of the circulatory system or to get clear out of the complete body of the rat, for how much time the drug is present inside that particular test organism, whether this compound is safe or it is causing multiple damage to the tissues. I am targeting lungs, whether it is causing any bystander damage to kidneys, any side effects to liver. So all those studies are done in the path of discovery, and when it is done, then and then only we go ahead with the human clinical trials. You have to submit the report, and then the trial permission with the ethical committee has to be attained, and then you can go ahead with the trials. So what is the timeline? If I say what is the timeline, that it, how much time it takes, how much time it takes for particular, you know, a drug to come from a bench to a clinic. Then once the compound is synthesized, it's, we have shown its antiviral effect. Majority of the compounds are rejected because out of the 100 compounds you have taken, only one or two will be very potent. Once you have taken the potent compounds, then you see whether their toxicity is acceptable or not. Majority of the compounds are removed from this path because of associated toxicities. So again, a filtration in vitro. Then you went to animal model. The things which are showing positive 100% effective in vitro condition, they might show only 60% effectiveness in vivo, because it is a complex organism that is performing the coordinated work. Here you are talking about the individual cell, right? And then when you see the toxicity profile in the animals, then further there is a filtration of multiple molecules. So you see, if you started with 1,000, you're eventually landing up with 100 in animal studies, or 50. 100 is a very optimistic number, 50 or 20 or even 10, even 5. Then you go to human trials with, say, 3 molecules or 2 molecules or single molecule. And then by the time you enter the trial, the first trial is done for toxicity. And majority of the drugs, almost, it's my assumption that almost 95 to 96% of the drugs are filtered out of this particular channel in the class 1 trial itself, because they are toxic towards the human. Why? Because again, the complexity is increasing. You have the complexity from rat to humans is very different. So toxicity is there. And then if it has cleared the toxicity, then you go for trial 2 and trial 3 to see the efficacy. And if it has cleared all the parameters, then and then only that particular compound is approved for general use. So you see the timeline required. You see the timeline required. The amount of work you did in your lab, the amount of work you did to synthesize a compound. Then if you are rejected here, you are again going back to scratch zero. If you're rejected at clinical trial 1, you are going again to that scratch zero to synthesize and to follow this particular path. If you are going at a fast pace, that how much time it takes from 8 to 12 years to, you know, to release a potent antiviral drug, new drug inside the market. And this is how drug discovery occurs in the clinic, that it takes 4 to 5 years to synthesize a drug. Then it takes a preclinical studies of 2 years to perform. Then the surveillance of, you know, safety studies from phase 1, phase 2 and phase 3, and then an FDA approval, and then finally the large cohort study of clinical trial 4. Now it takes from 8 to 10 years, and it may take $100 to $200 million to, you know, release an antiviral compound. So what are the mechanisms that are used to, you know, screen out this? See here, suppose this is a viral protein. It's a protein. A protease is coming and cleaving between B and C, and thereby two proteins are formed. This is a active mechanism what a virus is doing. In lab, what we have done, in this particular lab, what we have done, we have attached a signaling fluorochrome, and there is a bead which is responsible for suppressing the fluorescence of this particular FITC molecule. So when it is intact, it will not give any signal. But when it is cleaved by protease, it will be cleaved and be removed from this particular segment, and it will start giving you the signal, the fluorescence intensity. So if my drug is able to inhibit this cleavage of viral protein, if my drug is able to inhibit this protease molecule, the viral protease, the inhibitor of this viral protease enzyme, if my drug is the inhibitor, then what it will do? If I will give the drug, there will be no cleavage, there will be no signal that I was gaining. So there will be reduction in the fluorescence intensity in terms of the concentration what I'm giving in the form of drug. This is how we go about in completely deciphering that, yes, what are the mechanisms that we are talking about? What are the different scenarios that we are talking about? So in this particular lecture, what we have understood? In this particular lecture, we have understood that we have got to have basic understanding of the virus, the pathogenesis of the virus, the mode of infection of the virus, at what stage what we are targeting, how much effort it takes to, you know, take a drug, synthesize a drug in the laboratory, do studies, and then gain an approval for clinical use, how much expenditure is required, how much effort it is required. So for those scenarios, I have given you certain references which are very, very nice articles and very nice representations of antivirals, which will tell you that how much effort and what are the different types of antivirals that we are talking about, like we discussed the amantadine part. So based on this understanding, students, let us discuss certain aspects that we should understand based on this study. What are the MCQs that we are talking about? Because MCQs are the ways that we, you know, recapitulate what we have understood. This MCQs are the tools to remove your confusion. So, which of the following virus causes respiratory illness? Is it SARS? Is it influenza? Is it adeno? Is it SARS? Or, is it influenza? It is adeno. So, what we say that all of the viruses that are present here are responsible for causing this particular infection. Then, what else? Let's talk about the other MCQs that are present here. See, the next is, which of the target can be utilized as target for antiviral drug? There can be multiple targets, depending upon the PPT, you should read and answer later. Then, acyclovir. When we're talking about a compound antiviral drug, that is acyclovir. This is another potent compound, acyclovir, which is used against influenza infection, So, which of them is the influenza virus? What is the cytokine that is used among the IL-2, interferon, IL-6, TGF-beta? If we are talking about influenza virus, whether the inhibition of influenza virus is focused on attachment, if it is attaching on the surface, which of the following can be used for inhibiting the attachment? Then which of the following antiviral can act as base analog? Which of them is actually representing the structural analog of that particular pyrimidine or purine? Then a well-known drug called as Tamiflu, it is used to treat what? The Tamiflu is used to treat what? Then again, Relenza. Relenza is again the similar kind of antiviral drug as of Tamiflu, and they both are used to treat the same disease or the same virus. Then, which action of the enzyme converts a prodrug to active drug? We had studied that. Which of the following viruses are sexually transmitted viruses? Whether it is HIV or papillomavirus or herpes simplex virus. So friends, with this particular narration, you should be able to understand that how much effort it takes to develop an antiviral, what is exactly what we meant by a screening of antiviral compounds. So in next lecture, we'll be focusing on different antiviral compounds that are used, starting from acyclovir, amantadine, flavipir, and we'll be going sequentially in identifying 4 or 5 putative target antiviral compounds, and we'll see how those compounds are actually causing inhibition of the viruses. So this is all for, you know, today's lecture, and maybe it was useful for you. Please go ahead with the presentation, try to understand the basic concepts, and then